Good morning. Wherever we gather on holy ground. Our church building stands on native lands in what is now Santa Fe, called in Tewa, Ogapoge. Wherever you are watching from, it is likely that you too abide on land taken from indigenous people. We acknowledge this painful past as an important step towards reconciliation. Welcome, friends. My name is Jennifer, and my pronouns are she, her, and hers. I am the worship associate today. Thank you for joining us this morning. We are delighted to welcome Reverend Gary Kowalski to our pulpit this morning to give Reverend Gail a break today. Many of you will remember Gary as a former interim minister for UU Santa Fe, and he has stuck around in the Southwest to make wonderful music, beautiful paintings, and enjoy the outdoors. Gary's pronouns are he, him, and his, and he is currently serving Taos and Durango congregations. If you are joining us for the first or second time and you have not introduced yourself in the chat online, please make sure you do so. We appreciate knowing who's watching with us. If you have a joy or sorrow to share with our community, please email it to joysandsorrows@uusantafe.org right now, and we'll read it later in the service. If it doesn't make it in today, we'll get it in next week. And if for some reason our stream gets interrupted, which happens every now and then, please log back on. We will get things back on track just as quickly as we can.
The opening words this morning are from Reinhold Niebuhr's The Irony of American History. Nothing that is worth doing can be achieved in our own lifetime. Therefore, we must be saved by hope. Nothing that is true or good or beautiful makes complete sense in any immediate context of history. Therefore, we must be saved by faith. Nothing that we do, however virtuous, is quite as virtuous from the standpoint of our friend or foe as it is from our own standpoint. Therefore, we are saved by love and by the final form of love, which is forgiveness.
Please repeat after me and kindle your chalice at home as we kindle ours here. A chalice lit in our midst is a symbol of our faith.
A chalice lit in our midst is a symbol of our faith.
A faith built on the foundations of freedom, reason, and welcome.
Faith built on the foundations of freedom, reason, and welcome.
A faith sustained by acts of kindness and justice.
Faith sustained by acts of kindness and justice.
A faith that envisions a world flourishing.
A faith that envisions a world flourishing.
With equality for all people.
With equality for all people.
A faith that demands the living out of goodness.
A faith that demands the living out of goodness.
A faith that requires thoughtfulness.
A faith that requires thoughtfulness.
A faith of wholeness.
A faith of wholeness.
This tiny flame is the symbol.
This tiny flame is the symbol.
Of the spark of all this within each of us.
Of the spark of all this within each of us.
This morning's story is very old. It's thousands of years old, in fact. It seems that there was once a wolf living in the woods, and it was winter time. It was cold. It was snowy. Game was scarce. There were hardly any rabbits, hardly even any mice. The wolf was so hungry, sometimes he went to bed without any dinner at all. And one day, while he was walking in the forest, he happened to come across a dog who was also taking a stroll. And this dog seemed to be very fit and sleek and well-fed. And he seemed friendly, so the wolf and the dog fell into a conversation with each other. And the wolf asked the dog, "How is it, Mr. Dog, that you seem so fat and well-fed? Where do you get your food?" And the dog replied, "Well, that's easy. I live with my master, and my master takes care of me and feeds me well. If you'd like to come home with me, Mr. Wolf, I'm sure he'd feed you too." Well, the wolf was famished, and this was a very tempting offer. But then the wolf noticed that the fur all around the dog's neck was worn away. He was almost bald, and the wolf asked him, what happened to your fur there?" The dog said, "Well, that's where the metal links on the chain rub against my neck when my master chains me up every night. But don't worry about being chained. You'll soon get used to it." Well, the wolf thought about that. He thanked the dog and went his separate way, thinking to himself, better to be hungry and free than well-fed and live in chains. So I said, this is a very old story. It was told by a man named Aesop. And Aesop told lots of fables, lots of tales about dogs and wolves and rabbits and hares and ants and grasshoppers. But his stories weren't really about animals at all, because you see, Aesop was a slave. He lived on a Greek island called Samos, where he made his living picking grapes. But Aesop himself was not a Greek. He was an African, like his parents, who were slaves before him. So he told these stories about animals, because talking about animals seemed safe and harmless and would not get him into trouble with those he worked for. But his stories were really about slaves and masters, about the rich and powerful and gifted and those who didn't have so much power at all. So, to really understand a story, you sometimes have to know who was telling it, and when, and why.
Our joys shine more brightly, and our sorrows are lighter when they are shared. We don't have any in our book today. We start with a couple of joys and sorrows that didn't get in last weekend from Holland Shepherd. He was mourning the loss of E.O. Wilson, one of the greatest minds of the 20th and 21st century, who died last week. He raised our consciousness and gave hope for the future regarding human impacts and on natural systems and the importance of biological diversity. Thank you for the reminder, Holland. I sent one in last weekend, noting that Kenan and I had had a wonderful holiday with our two daughters, one of the daughters' fiancés, and occasional other friendly visitors. It was remarkably relaxed and fun, even though we moved Christmas dinner outside with a fire pit for safety. We had fabulous food and adventures. Holidays in retirement are so much easier. Elizabeth Swope reminds us this week of some of our friends and members who are having birthdays this week. Catherine Salverson, Roger Brumley, Anne Morgan, and Anne Hume. We hope you all have a happy birthday. And now, let us hold in our hearts all the joys and sorrows we have shared as we light one last candle for the joys and sorrows not yet spoken, as we listen to Lydia play Spirit of Life. Please keep your masks on, but you are welcome to hum along.
In 1932, Reinhold Niebuhr wrote a prayer that would become very famous. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. During World War II, thousands of GIs would carry that prayer with them into battle. And after the war, Alcoholics Anonymous and other 12-step groups would adopt that same prayer for people who were fighting other kinds of battles with addiction and depression. In 1951, Niebuhr added to the prayer in words that I've adapted for our morning meditation. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking, as sages have counseled, this imperfect world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to the divine, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and at one with the eternal that surrounds it. May we now lean into our own lives and struggles with serenity and grace. So be it.
Thank you, Lydia. The reading this morning is the poem Let America Be America Again by Langston Hughes. Hughes was a key figure in the flowering of Black consciousness and culture known as the Harlem Renaissance. He was not just an outstanding African American poet, but one of the premier literary voices of the 20th century. Hughes wrote this poem in 1935, in the midst of the Great Depression. Let America be America again. Let it be the dream it used to be. Let it be the pioneer on the plain, seeking a home where he himself is free. America never was America to me. Let America be the dream the dreamers dreamed. Let it be that great, strong land of love, where never kings connive nor tyrants scheme, that any man be crushed by one above. It never was America to me. Oh, let my land be a land where liberty is crowned with no false patriotic wreath, but opportunity is real and life is free. Equality is in the air we breathe. There's never been this equality for me, nor freedom in this homeland of the free. Say, who are you that mumbles in the dark? And who are you that draws your veil across the stars? I am the poor white, fooled and pushed apart. I am the Negro bearing slavery scars. I am the red man driven from the land. I am the immigrant clutching the hope I seek and finding only the same old stupid plan of dog eat dog, of mighty crush the weak. I am the young man full of strength and hope, tangled in that ancient, endless chain of profit, power, gain, and grab the land. Of grab the gold, of grab the ways of satisfying need, of work the men, of take the pay, of owning everything for one's own greed. I am the farmer, bondsman to the soil. I am the worker, sold to the machine. I am the Negro, servant to you all. I am the people, humble, hungry, mean, hungry yet today, despite the dream, beaten yet today. Oh, pioneers, I am the man who never got ahead, the poorest worker bartered through the years. Yet, I'm the one who dreamt our basic dream in the old world while still a serf of kings, who dreamt a dream so strong, so brave, so true, that even yet its mighty daring sings in every brick and stone, in every furrow turned that's made America the land it has become. Oh, I'm the man who sailed those early seas in search of what I meant to be my home. For I'm the one who left dark Ireland's shore and Poland's plain and England's grassy lea, and torn from black Africa's strand I came to build a homeland of the free. The free? Who said the free? Not me? Surely not me. The millions on relief today? The millions shot down when we strike? The millions who have nothing for our pay? For all the dreams we've dreamed, and all the songs we've sung, and all the hopes we've held, and all the flags we've hung, the millions who have nothing for our pay, except the dream that's almost dead today. Oh, let America be America again, the land that has never been yet, and yet must be, the land where every man is free, the land that's mine, the poor man's, Indians, Negroes, me, who made America, whose sweat and blood, whose faith and pain, whose hand at the foundry, whose plow in the rain must bring back our mighty dream again. Sure, call me any ugly name you choose. The steel of freedom does not stain. From those who live like leeches on the people's lives, we must take back our land again, America. Oh yes, I say it plain. America never was America to me, and yet I swear this oath, America will be.
Jennifer, thank you. When I was in seminary all those many years ago, I learned lots of fancy words, words like eschatology and deontological. But one of the best phrases that I picked up that stayed with me was the hermeneutic of suspicion. This refers to the way that critical scholars read the Bible, not accepting every word at face value, but trying to understand who wrote that text and what audience they were trying to persuade, and something of the historical context behind it. In other words, reading the book and looking for hidden agendas. So, for example, some of the letters of Paul, or attributed to Paul in our New Testament, were were probably not written by him at all, because they're addressing concerns of the early church that didn't arise until the second century. And so, for example, the historical Jesus almost certainly did not utter every word ascribed to him. Some people were putting words into his mouth for reasons of their own. A few years back, a group of scholars called the Jesus Seminar used a hermeneutic of suspicion to try to guess at which parts of the gospel could be traced back to that original man from Galilee. They decided that short, catchy phrases like "turn the other cheek," these were more likely to be authentic than long, wordy discourses, because they were more likely to survive the generations of oral tradition that preserved his words before they were actually written down. But not everything could be genuine. In Matthew 16, for instance, Jesus calls Peter the rock on which I found my church. But there wasn't any Christian church at that point. So this was almost certainly the invention of some later editor. And the criteria that they used to distinguish the real stuff from the counterfeit could be debated, and it certainly was debated, but that was their approach. So what does this have to do with critical race theory? CRT, as it's known, has become a buzzword in America. It's become a flashpoint for controversy. Critical race theory has been bashed repeatedly on Fox News. Several states have passed laws banning it from the public schools. And in response, lots of people have felt compelled to defend critical race theory, which until a year or two ago, probably most of us had never heard of. And in public discourse, it's become a caricature, a boogeyman conjured by certain politicians who want to whip up the base. And all this cacophony, I became confused. I lost the signal amidst the noise, and maybe you did too. So what is critical race theory? Well, the best explanation that I've been able to come up with is that critical race theory simply means that American history and its foundational documents should be studied with a hermeneutic of suspicion. CRT arose as a stance in legal studies and jurisprudence. Scholars like Derek Bell suggested that laws and statutes and court rulings that appeared on their surface to be race neutral had to be read with some skepticism because their actual impact might be to perpetuate inequality. So, for example, the 13th Amendment to the Constitution appeared to abolish slavery. It's what I learned in school. It's usually taught that way. The language reads, "Neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for a crime whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist in the United States or any place under their jurisdiction." But of course, we all know that slavery was replaced by a system of Jim Crow and economic peonage and mass incarceration that left as many blacks in the penal system today as were in bondage when that amendment was ratified in 1865. The hermeneutic of suspicion requires us to examine any legal institutional change affecting African Americans as tending to keep entrenched power relations in place. So, Brown v. Board of Education in 1954. That was supposed to end segregation in the public schools. The Fair Housing Act in 1968. That was supposed to lead to integrated neighborhoods, and neither of those really panned out. Public schools today are still pretty much color-coded. Big cities like Detroit are almost entirely black, while nearby wealthy suburbs like Grosse Pointe are almost entirely white, despite whatever the law says. The birth of standardized testing, beginning in 1947 with the Educational Testing Service, that was supposed to create a kind of meritocracy of smart, talented young people. It was supposed to end the idea that college admissions would be just reserved for the wealthy or the well-connected. And how did that go? You know, I got high SAT scores because I'm good at taking tests. And I went to Harvard despite being a Polack from Oklahoma. So I tend to think standardized testing can be a pretty good thing. But a black child's family income is still a better predictor than either grades or test scores of whether that child will go to college. Those who are on the bottom tend to stay there. Social and economic mobility in the U.S. is actually declining. And even conservative publications like Forbes report that children born into poverty today are likely to be trapped there. Well, all we have to do is look around to see that the rich are getting richer. So the more things change, the more they stay the same. And in this sense, critical race theory is nothing new. In his book, Moral Man, Immoral Society, from 1932, the Christian theologian Reinhold Niebuhr suggested that modern societies inevitably rest on a concentration of power and an imbalance of power. Industrial capitalism is characterized by those who are owners and those who are workers, which leads to the haves and the have-nots. The powerful habitually use their leverage to maintain their own advantage, naturally, hiding behind a defense that their privileges are entirely rational or democratically determined or all perfectly legal, or the result of an impartial marketplace. And Niebuhr was writing as the pastor of a congregation in Detroit at the height of the Great Depression. And this was an epoch that was similar to, but also different than our own. Then there were soup lines. Now we have food banks. Then there were hobos. Now we have the homeless. Then there was a rising worldwide tide of fascism. Now we have a rising worldwide tide of fascism. Niebuhr considered himself to be a realist. He thought that these internal contradictions and power struggles in society would never be resolved just by moral suasion, or through better education, or by more intelligent debate where we could all better understand the issues and come together in consensus around some reasonable solution. He doubted that we could all just be friends. He thought that power would never yield without a fight. And in a similar fashion, CRT applies a hermeneutic of suspicion to claims that rationality or principles of economic or political liberalism can solve all our problems, because sometimes liberalism is the problem. Really, I haven't been able to come up with a better definition of critical race theory that works for me. It's kind of like the historical critical method of studying the Bible, which used to be called the higher criticism. It's not a body of content like teaching people about the Tulsa race massacre. Instead, it's a perspective that tries to look behind the stated intentions of lawmakers and others who are influencing the public square, to see how their actions are actually either dismantling or maintaining this myth that we are living in a totally free and fair and colorblind society. That may be an aspiration, that may be a noble ideal, but as it applies to the real world, it is very much a myth. CRT has some similarities to the religious doctrine of original sin, of which Niebuhr was an adherent. He thought that egoism and tribal loyalties would infect all our social relationships so that a completely disinterested or impartial benevolence toward our fellow creatures is just not possible. Consider this, for example. It's very, very hard to follow the golden rule, doing unto others. Maybe you manage it all the time. Raise your hand if that's easy for you. It's not so easy for me. But I'd suggest that none of us are capable of loving others as they love themselves. You know, that's not humanly achievable. We're just not wired that way. An original sin is a phrase that makes a lot of us squirm, but think about it this way. I think that we're all born into this world with both a moral sense and with a moral blind spot. Our moral sense is what allows us to empathize with other people. It's what allows us to feel compassion, to tell right from wrong, to consider the common collective good. And this is what Jews and Christians and maybe even Unitarians mean when we talk about people being made in the image of God or born with inherent worth and dignity. But alongside that moral sense, our moral blind spot also prevents us from ever truly walking a mile in another person's moccasins. We judge ourselves by our own best moments, by our good intentions, while we judge other people by their actual behavior and their misdeeds. We can make excuses for ourselves, other people not so much, especially if they speak a different language or we think they look funny. This is human nature. It's what Niebuhr meant by original sin, and it's what gives this notion some credibility for me. In his book, Moral Man, Immoral Society, Niebuhr suggested that as individuals, we see ourselves, we perceive ourselves as moral beings. That's how we function, too. We're kind to our pets. We serve on church committees, or we work with our local volunteer fire department, or we work with philanthropic organizations. We're not consciously or deliberately mean, far from it. But considered in mass as an anonymous collective, we human beings behave in ways that shock the conscience. As members of an immoral society, we acquiesce to wars and mass slaughter. As members of an immoral economy, we spend and consume in ways that intend no harm, but that often carry a terrible price to other people and the environment. As law-abiding citizens, we pay our taxes. We support an apparatus that guards against any instability that might upset the prevailing pecking order. And so we are not necessarily biased or prejudiced as individuals, the proponents of critical race theory might say, but collectively, institutionally, we're guilty because racism is America's original sin. But if that's even partly true, how do we make it right? How do we atone? What does redemption even begin to look like? When the historical critical method of studying the Bible came to the fore late in the 19th century, this created a schism, a crisis within Christianity. It saw a split, an ongoing conflict between the fundamentalists and the modernists. The fundamentalists turned their back on the emerging scholarship. They insisted that every word of Scripture was literally true. They took the myths and legends of the Bible to be facts beyond dispute. Jesus really walked on water. He was born of a virgin. He really rose to heaven. The Gospels were eyewitness accounts. And why would they lie? And then there were the modernists. The modernists distinguished between what they called the Jesus of history and the Christ of faith. They admitted that many purported events in the Bible probably never happened. Jesus likely did not say, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And yet, nevertheless, we've all experienced guilt and shame. And we know that the experience of being loved unconditionally can bring a profound sense of healing and self-acceptance into our lives. I think we have probably all been in that tomb of despair when we see no way out and we feel powerless and hopeless, but then somehow we are touched by grace and despite ourselves, the rock rolls away and we experience a rebirth. And these are realities of the mind and spirit. And I think now that we're seeing a similar bifurcation, American fundamentalists want to insist on the immaculate conception of the United States, untouched by any impure thought or motive. George Washington really threw a silver dollar across the Potomac. He really never told a lie. John Wayne fought at the Alamo and died for our sins. The words of the pledge, one nation under God, indivisible, with equal justice and liberty for all, these are taken to be descriptive rather than prescriptive. They're understood to be an actual accounting of our last 400 years. But this is not history. This is dogma. And not only that, it's a dangerous distortion. And the modernist has to answer. Almost exactly a century ago, the minister of the Riverside Church in New York City delivered a memorable sermon titled, "Shall the Fundamentalists Win?" And it's a question that's more pertinent than ever. I think our response has to be to distinguish between the America of history and the America of faith. The America of history is deeply flawed and has never delivered on its pledge of equal justice under the law. But that should not stop us from embracing the promised land of faith, where sisterhood is powerful and brotherhood is real, and where every child is treated as a legitimate child, entitled to life and liberty in the pursuit of happiness, because all people are created equal. Black and white, brown, freckled, female, male and transgender, gay, straight. This is our creed. This is our faith. And it's up to us to live that out, to create a more perfect union.
Wow. I learned so much from that, Gary. Thank you. This is why I come here. to hear things like that, and why I give. We are blessed by the gifts of this community, and we give of our gifts that others may likewise be blessed. Today, we thank you for your support of UU Santa Fe, and if you are in this room, you may place gifts for UU Santa Fe in the baskets by the doors as you exit. If you are at home, you can find the donate button on our webpage. We also want to thank you for our January community partner, and when this month's partner is identified, there will be a link for that on our donate page. And also on our webpage, there's information about our Afghan refugee project and donations needed for that. Thank you.
Changed my mind about the piece that I was going to play. I'm going to reiterate something.
Thank you. So we're going to extinguish our chalice now. And although we extinguish our chalice flames, we do not extinguish the light of truth or the fires or warmth of community or of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Our closing words are from Martin Luther King, Jr. He said that however dark the moment, however difficult the hour, it would not be long until we reached that promised land. How long? Not long, because no lie can live forever. How long? Not long, because you still reap what you sow. How long? Not long, because truth pressed to the earth will rise again. How long? Not long, because the moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you for joining us today, friends. We hope that you enjoyed today's service. Please take a little time and explore our website and visit our online welcome table if you'd like to know more about us. Otherwise, we'll see you next Sunday morning. Stay in touch and be well.